Welcome.
Hello.
Live from the treehouse in Phoenix, Arizona.
Hello, Mark. Check mark.
Sir Christopher Peralta, a.k.a. Woodsy.
Good afternoon, good evening, good morning.
How are you?
Good, sir. How are you doing?
Excellent. Welcome to a Not Conscious, everybody. Today, we had a pretty awesome interview. Or actually, I don't even call it an interview.
It was a great conversation.
It was a conversation. We don't do interviews. We're not those people. Don't be that guy. We had a great conversation with a Mr. Brian Propp. He is one of only 90 people to ever score 1,000 points in the NHL. He's a hockey legend, Philadelphia Flyer legend. Watermark was so in love with him when he came on. He was so happy over there. We were starting chanting, "Let's go Flyers."
No, we were not.
We were not. I did my best to not fanboy too much. I hope I didn't sound too gushy.
You were good, dude.
You were better.
I know, but thank you.
Yeah, some great questions. You're better that one time, man. Remember that one time?
Yeah. Yeah.
No, but it was phenomenal. Thank you, Chris, for being on that ride. Learned some really interesting things.
Absolutely.
And you'll hear the interview in a second. Chris, any final thoughts on
that? I appreciate you busting your butt to get Mr. Proper on the show, because I think everything you had to say about his career and his injury after he retired and his recovery, it's an amazing story. And I think to bring awareness to stroke victims is very important. And head injuries as well is something that is important to both of us. And some of the alternative therapies that he does still, I think we should all look into. And I think those are really cool things that we could bring up to everybody. So I appreciate you working so hard to do all that.
Thank you. And a special thank you does go out to my brother. He's actually the one who has the connection. He's the one who connected us. So thank you for that. On the show notes, we will be having an affiliate link for the Kafa cigars that are charity driven as well.
Which we did order today.
Which we also ordered today. So once again, this is Brian Propp, and I hope you enjoy the conversation. Welcome, Mr. Propp. Tell us a little bit about your background and where you grew up and how you got to where you got. We'd love to hear your story, so please feel free to share away.
Yeah, so my name is Brian Propp. I grew up in Saskatchewan in Canada. That's in the middle of Canada. So I had my dad was a Lutheran minister, and he preached in German and English every week. And so I didn't learn German, but it was okay after that. And I have two brothers and two sisters. They were all 13 months apart. So at the start, we had our own hockey team because we only had 300 people in the town. So, that way it made it much better for us to play hockey together and grow up together. And it's a simple life. We just lived on the farm and the plains where it was very cold in January and February. It was minus 40 below every day. And so all you had to do was skate and go to school. And in the summer, you played some sports and you just had some fun. So for me, it was it was pretty easy because, you didn't know anything. You just grew up the way you were, and you wanted to make an impact in your life. And then when I was 15, my dad taught me, all the basics of hockey. And I turned out to be a good hockey player. So when I was 15, I played for the Melville Millionaires in Saskatchewan. It was a junior team. And I set the records for points, and I smacked all the records, and were the MVP. I didn't know any better. I just had fun and played hockey. But my dad taught me how to be a good sport, how to give back, and how to be humble. And so that's what I learned from him. And it made a big difference for me, too. And then after that, I played 3 years for the Brandon Wheat Kings in Manitoba, which is the World Hockey, Western Hockey League. And we had powerful teams. And then, I remember when I started with the Brandon, Dunk McCollin was my coach. He played in the NHL for 15 years, and he taught us how to work hard and to, you know, do things a little better so that you get ready to be them in the pros. But I also had a couple of really good friends, Ray Allison and Brad McCrimmon, that played with me for the last 3 years at that time. And unfortunately, Brad died in a plane crash like 8 years ago. And Ray Allison, he still is with me in Cherry Hill. And so I see him quite often. So it's just nice to keep up with the people that we started our lives with. And we had good teams in Brandon. My first season, we only lost 12 games. My second season, we only lost 8 games. Wow. And my final season, we only lost 5 games, if you can imagine that. That's how powerful our team was. That was pretty amazing.
It's interesting. I pulled up the Melvin Millionaires, and you scored 75 goals and 92 assists for 168 points in 57 games.
Yeah, I had a good coach, you know, because at that year it was Jerry James, who was he won a Stanley Cup in Toronto, and he also was a football player. He was a kicker. So he learned from football how to put prepare and how they put the lines together, how they organize everything. So we were way ahead of where it was at that time.
That's amazing. I mean, it's just so. Did you win the championship all 3 years with them?
No. So what, you know, my first year in the playoffs in Melville, like we lost, and then my 3 other years, like we lost again. But at the final season, like we lost it overtime, the Memorial Cup, which is a big deal. And you know, so but you know, we did as well as we could. We were happy to be where we were, and you know, it was good for me. And then after that, because we did so well and I scored a lot in the juniors, then I got drafted by the Philadelphia Flyers in 1979. And so that was when the league merged. There was only one league, and it was the NHL. Before, it was the World Hockey Association and the NHL. And so, you know, I didn't know any better. I just did what I was told, and you know, we didn't have any bargaining power out at that time because there's only one league. And so, you know, I ended up only making 60, 65, and 70,000 my first 3 years. Otherwise, it could have been like 150 or more at that time, which was huge. But now it's a lot different. Now the guys are making millions of dollars, and they don't have to work as hard for everything that they have. But
how old were you when you got drafted?
I was 19.
Wow. And was how, and so when that happened, how was that expected of you? Was that, I mean, did you assume that was going to happen at that young of an age?
Well, I was one of the best players in the league, for juniors at that time. And, but when the league merged, then it changed to an 18-year-old draft too. So a couple other players were drafted ahead of me, like Laurie Boschman, who played for me in Brandon, and Ray Bourque, who won the Rookie of the Year that year. Okay. But I was happy that, you know, a couple people that I know, like the scouts before, they said that I was a bad liver, and so I drank too much, and so that's why they passed on my. Otherwise, I would have been drafted in the top 5. But it actually ended up worked out better for me because I went to the Philadelphia Flyers, where I was in the playoffs my first 13 years consecutively.
Wow.
And so that's, you know, made a big difference for me just being there with, you know, just with the Flyers, and then playing with Bobby Clark as a leader. And me, I worked the same as Bob Clark. You know, we were from the West, and we kind of knew how to win. And so for me, it was really, you know, nice for me just to get where I was. But I, you know, at that time, like I was working on the farm. I didn't even know when I got drafted and who to. And so I got a call from the Philadelphia Flyers that I was got drafted. And so I was like, oh, okay, that's okay, because I wasn't big on following hockey. And a lot of the other guys were, but, you know, for me, it was just really good for them, you know, to get them drafted. And then I started right at the start, and I played from right there.
That's great. But I think the important question is, what was your drink of choice?
Well, it was beer, of course, the Canadian course. Beer. Like, there's a good beer, like Labatt's. I like nice. Labatt's.
Yes.
Now, you know, and, you know, of course, you know, when you're young, you had fun. And you know, after my stroke 5 years ago, like, I stopped drinking like 4 years ago. So just to be a little healthier. But, you know, I like a beer every once in a while, but not anymore. But, you know, but it was good. And you know, the first year, you know, for the Flyers, you know, I remember we won the first game. I scored the game-winning goal in my first game against Bill Smith, and played with Bob Clark and Reggie Leach on the line. And then I switched after that to Kenny Linsman and Paul Holmgren, and Bill Barber took over my place. But, you know, I won the, you know, first game. I scored a goal and had an assist, you know, good way to get started. And then we lost 9-2. So I was like, oh my God, is this what the NHL is going to be like? And then we went 35 without a loss, which was amazing. And the record is still today, probably won't ever be broken. And then my first year went to the finals in my first season as a rookie, and we lost to the Islanders that year. Otherwise, if it's not an overtime goal, we probably win in game seven. But you know, it didn't work. But it was a good start for me just to get started with my career with 74 without a loss, and then the Stanley Cup Finals.
That's amazing. Not to pick at that scab, but I was born in 74, so I was born right between the two Flyers championships, Stanley Cups. So I am obviously like married to the Flyers. I bleed orange and black.
Well, you were born in Philadelphia.
Well, yes, I was born in Philadelphia.
Born and raised
as well.
In Philly, right?
And the 1980 Islander, was it the offside? Was that the infamous offside call? That the fan that didn't happen, and they scored a goal off of it.
Well, that was one, but I think a lot of people kept thinking that the overtime goal was offside. It wasn't, but the other game, the goal that to tie the game at two apiece was Sutter, and I was right there, but it was like 2 feet off, and so like everyone just stopped, and then it kept playing, and then it was like then they scored, and otherwise it could have made a big difference, but. You know, at that time, you know, you don't worry about it. Like, you know, we were tied after the game, and then so, you know, I knew that we had to win to force a game seven, and unfortunately, the Islanders won in overtime.
Oh wow, that's a great story. So after that, tell us about a little bit about your career with the Flyers in the 80s, because you had a lot of success there as well, all throughout the 80s.
Yeah, so like as I said, you know, I was with the Flyers from 79 to 90, 11 years, and you know, had good coaches. Pat Quinn was a good coach, and then McCammon was there. I didn't like him, and then Keenan was there for 4 years, and then Paul Holmgren at the end. So I had good coaching, but the thing about the Flyers is that they draft people with character. So they put the team together knowing the character can be a big difference. And then, of course, with Bob Clark starting and, you know, Bill Barber and, you know, and myself and then other leaders, you know, then after 5 years, like Bobby Clark was the GM. And then we had Mark Howe and Dave Poulin and myself kind of were leaders, and Brad McCrimmon, of course. But we took care of our own team. They didn't have to worry about what we did because we were so good and disciplined. And so that made a big difference with the leadership that we had at that time. So that's why we won all the time. And, you know, so like, and then we went to the finals in 85 and then 87. And then and Pelly died in 85 after the season. And then Hextall started in 87. So, you know, we had good goalies and we had a good chance to win. But the Islanders, like, they won four in a row. They were really tough to play on. And then they switched the conference after the second round. Otherwise, you know, we ran into each other too much. And then Edmonton was too strong. And after that, for 4 years. And so it was tough to win at that time because those best teams were there for so many years. You know, I just remember that we were in the playoffs every time. But I noticed that, you know, I struggled my second and third year in the playoffs because I was expected to score. And because the goalies played so well, I didn't score that much. And so I got roasted by the press, you know, even though I was playing well. But I learned a big lesson from that because it taught me that I had to be much better in the playoffs in the first round after I lost a couple of years. And so I learned from that. And then I also had a chance to play for Team Canada in Germany and Finland for the World Championships. So that gave me a little more time to think about, you know, playing a little bit better and then playing for your country. And so, like, you know, it was it helped me because I learned at an early age I had to be much better when the playoffs roll around.
That's amazing. So the pressure, I like I said, growing up in Philadelphia, you know the Boo Birds, right? And the pressure that you have put on you as an exceptional player and how you can't take a day off. How do you handle something like that? How do you handle that pressure?
Well, I was very consistent, and so I didn't have to worry about that. Like, I was one of the best players all the time, and I was quiet, and I just made a difference with the team of how we played. And that's why I was so consistent, and so that people knew that we, as long as we tried hard, nobody would mind. And, you know, in the 90s, like when I got traded, and then they didn't make the playoffs for 5 years, it was bad. You know, but I played against. I was in Boston, and I went to the finals, and then I was in Minnesota for a year, and then went to the finals there, and then I ended up in Hartford for a year, and then I went to play for France for a year. So, you know, I continued to play better in the playoffs with Boston. We went to the finals and almost won, and then against Minnesota, we went to the finals and almost won. So, like, I was in 5 Stanley Cup Finals, even though I didn't win any, but I produced and was a key factor in the whole things. And so that's why, you know, for my stats, you know, like my memory of the playoffs is key because I'm still number one in the history of the game for left wing scorers. With points, 64 goals, 84 assists, 148 points in 160 games. And so I'm very proud of that. And, you know, just they won't ever take that away from me. But other than that, you know, I'm still kind of working to see if I can get in the Hall of Fame, NHL Hall of Fame, because I was so quiet. And but, you know, we're working on that with a couple of friends just to see if we can promote it a little better and see if I can get in.
Well, I definitely will be pushing for that for sure.
Yeah, we'll vote for you.
What's interesting is it's funny because we always look at like points per game, right? Each goal is a point. Each assist is a point. You almost averaged a point per game your entire career.
Yes, that's why I was so consistent. You know, so like when I played as a team, I didn't worry about the spot, the points. You know, I could have scored more points, but I didn't want to do that. I wanted to win for the team, and that's why I played defensive and offensive together. I was one of the best penalty killers in the 80s with Dave Poulin and myself. So yes, I'm very proud of that because you played both sides of the ice, and you know, in overall, for the forwards. In the history of the game, I'm plus 10 in the history of the game for forwards, you know, which is I'm very proud of, too.
That is. I mean, you were one of the best two-way players that I recall. The only one that comes to mind for me would be like a Pavel Datsyuk type, right? Just someone who always was on both ends of the ice.
Oh yeah, definitely. Yeah. So yeah. So like it was good for me. And then, of course, I want to talk about the Canada Cup in 1987.
Please. Because
that's, special to me. One of the best seasons, series in hockey, a three-game series against Russia and against Team Canada in September of 87. So, okay. I played with Lemieux and Gretzky on the line most of the tournament, and we filled with a couple other players, but we had great teams. The Russians were unbelievable because at that time, they couldn't get drafted into the NHL until 1990. So, like, they would have to defect if they wanted to play in the NHL. And that didn't happen at that time. So, at that time in 87, it was you hated Russia and Canada and the U.S. And so you didn't know any better. But, after time, now it's a little different with the way the world is. But, and I still remember we lost the first game 6-5. We won the second game. We wanted to in double overtime so to make it 6-5. And then we won the final game 6-5 with a minute left. And so that was a big a big prize for me just to be on the winning side after playing three Stanley Cup finals at the start.
Yeah, and playing for your country, how did that feel? Playing for your country for
everybody there, it plays a little different for your country because your country is different than playing for a team for the Stanley Cup Finals. Like everybody wants to win the Stanley Cup as a team, but for your country, it's so much better because you know everybody that in the country is rooting for you. And so, of course, I was able to be one of the top contributors for that. So I was really happy, with my career, especially at the start in the 80s. You know, it was a lot of fun. You know, I had a lot of great memories. And so I was very happy with my career.
That's amazing. So going into the mid-80s, I'm sure you're asked this all the time, but I can't not ask. But your celebration after scoring a goal started in about 86 or so in the 86-87 season. And you start in 79. Could you share with us what your celebration was, what it was called, and how you got to celebrate so many times?
Yeah. So like in the 80s, I went to Howie Mandel's show in Atlantic City a couple times, and I got to see him. I really liked what he did, and he's a Canadian comedian, and so I really liked that. And so I went to a couple shows, and then I said, "Hey, I want to do something a little different in the when I score goals in the NHL." So I started with the Flyers, and like in about '84, decided to take my glove off and center ice, and want to do something a little more fun. And so I did a little wave from my right to the left, and then I just said guffaw, a hearty laughter in the English dictionary. So I wanted something a little with more excitement, and so I started with that. And and I talked with Howie Mandel later. He didn't mind that I branded that. You know, I still trademarked that as a guffaw, and so. He didn't mind, and I talked with him a couple times. And like 6 months ago, I was just at a show in Atlantic City with him. Talked with him again, about his health problems and everything that he's doing, and how I had a stroke, and how it could be different for people that have to live a little bit differently. So, but it was good because when I first started in the 80s, Keenan was a coach, and so he said, "What is it? Don't ever do that again." And I said, "Yeah." I said, "Don't worry about it." I said, "I just kept it going," and then it kept.
I only laugh because I know the Mike Keenan of the Flyers. I just know how he just was he was just a commander, right? He kind of led. He didn't let you get out of hand, right?
That's right. Yeah.
So that's great. So, what's interesting is part of our connection is through my brother. And my understanding is my brother, you were playing for the Hartford Whalers when you scored your 1,000th point. And it was against the Flyers in Philadelphia. My brother actually attended that game. Is that correct?
Yes. Yes. I was at the end of the year. I was at 998 points, and I really wanted to get that milestone of 1,000 points. So I ended up scoring two goals that game against the Flyers, an afternoon game, as they were trying to get into the playoffs. And so I spoiled it for them. But for me, it was a big milestone for me to get the 1,000 points. And scoring two goals in Philadelphia in the Spectrum was really important for me to get. And so I'll remember that for as long as I live. It's just a thrill. And playing in front of the people that I had, like last 5 years of my life a lot of people were there. We had a great time. I was very happy that I got that accomplished.
That's amazing. And I can tell you from Philadelphia, we still love you. I know, even though probably that day was heartbroken for Philadelphia fans. But how satisfying was it to, first of all, your first game with Hartford was against Philadelphia, and your 1,000th point was against Philadelphia. How did that feel for you to also be able to like play spoiler in that case too, not just the 1,000th point?
Well, at that time, you're a competitor, and so it doesn't matter who you're playing for. It's you do the job, and so I was always a competitor that I didn't want to win to lose, and so. The Flyers were getting better in the 80s and 90s. And so, they had to keep work on it. But it took them a couple of years. But they got leaders there, and they had good players like Lindros and LeClaire. I mean, it's unbelievable that they didn't do as much as they, better as they did. But
only one final.
Having the good players, you get ready for it. And you can very good with playing against them.
That's great. And thank you for sharing all that. Do you have any more hockey stories before we move on to your charitable events or what happened,
Everything that's all pretty good. And then, I ended up a year in France after I retired after Hartford. I went to France for a year, which was, I really liked that because it was beautiful. I just wanted to figure out what I wanted to do after my career. And then I started with the Medford Ice Rink for 3 years, running the whole rink. And then I did the radio for the Flyers for 9 years, every game. And then I was at the Judge Group for 5 years. And now I've been at Wolf Commercial Real Estate the last 6 years. And I really like Wolf Commercial Real Estate as I'm a realtor. And I've been with them for 6 years. And we've set up a lot of things for that. It's, we set up a couple of charity hockey games. We did four of them. We did six former alumni with two teams and four goalies, and we raised money for the charities. And so the six charities that we support, we get a piece back from the money we raise. And the last year, we raised $80,000 for the hockey game. And then we also have a golf tournament the last couple of years that's raised another $40,000 for the six charities that we have too. So our Wolf Commercial Real Estate in Marlton and Philadelphia learns how to give back because it makes a huge difference for the charities that need the money.
That's great. So Chris, I understand you like golf.
Mr. Propp. I was reading all about you since I'm from Southern California. So I was not a big hockey person because the weather was too nice. So sadly, I was a Dodger fan and a Raiders fan growing up in the 70s and 80s. So I didn't get into hockey until probably 92 when my college roommate was a psycho and we'd watch a Friday night hockey night on ESPN because in the U.S. So I was reading all about you the last couple of days and boom, he's a golfer. I went, oh, yes. So, but I understand with your recent situation – now, how often do you get to go out and play golf?
Yeah, there's a lot of charity events that I go to, especially in the summer. But like last summer, like with the virus, we couldn't go out that much. And so at the end of the year, like in September, I had a lot of outings that were postponed and rescheduled. So, you know, I give a lot back to charity golfs that I play in, you know, like because now like the today's player for the Flyers don't want to play scrambles. They just rather play their own golf course. They make too much money. But, okay, you know, in the 80s, Ron Jaworski and the Eagles and other people that are still there, they know why they're here for the people, and they brand themselves the right way. So that's why there's lots of charities events that I have in the Philadelphia, New Jersey, and New York area. Yeah, so I used to, you know, love golf. I was a 4 handicap, but now I'm like 15 because wow, my right hand and right side doesn't work that well. But you know, I have fun with it all the time, and it's going really well. But golf and hockey is awesome. I still skate twice a week, Wednesday and Friday mornings, at Pensauken Skate Zoning in New Jersey, with a group of guys. We always have 2 goalies, 5-on-5, a couple subs, and we skate for an hour and a half from 7 to 8:30 each week. And so that's been really good, because of after my stroke, I still have good balance. Just that my fingers and the right side don't work that well, but I find out a way to play a lot better.
So speaking of the stroke, would you like to share with us your experience and kind of go through what happened for you? Because I understand you're a really strong advocate now. You've always given back, and that's one of the greatest things that people admire about you. Do you want to share a little bit about your story with the stroke and how it happened and go through that?
Yes. So I had a massive stroke on September 3rd, 2015. I was on vacation with my family in Annapolis, Maryland, because my children were just getting ready to go to college. And so we wanted to do a trip for a couple days. And so the first day I was doing okay. The second day I had a really bad headache. And I think that it's because I had AFib. But just so that you guys know that before that, like 10 years before that, I had an ablation of the heart, which means if you Google that, it's just it burns the ends of the sides out. And so then I was supposed to be much better, but I think after time, the medication wore off. And so that I was in good shape, but I didn't notice that I was in AFib. So what happened is I had AFib, which meant that the clot went into my heart to my brain. And so that night at 1:30 of the night, I fell out of bed. I couldn't talk. I couldn't move. I couldn't do anything. I hit the side of the bed. All those years playing hockey, I didn't lose any teeth. And so it was a nightmare. But thankfully, my family was there and saw that it happened. And they called the hospital right away. I was fortunate to be alive and with family when it happened. Otherwise, I might not be here today. So it's kind of scary. And at the start, I couldn't talk or move at all for the first 5 days. And then I got transferred to McGee Hospital, and I was there for six weeks every day in the hospital. And then I was able to kind of go 5 days a week at McGee, outpatient, and keep working on it. So the speech therapist, it took me the longest because at the start I couldn't talk at all. The only thing I could say at the start was and Bernie Pront. I don't know why that came across, but it did.
Well, Bernie, doesn't Bernie slip people's lips all the time? He's one of the greatest, isn't he?
Oh yeah, he's awesome. And I know I was ambassador for the Flyers the last 4 years, and he was part of that for 3 years, and I see him all the time at the shore. Like he has a place in Avalon, and we have a place in Sea Isle City, and so I talk with him all the time. But he kind of gives back a lot too. But the stroke at the start was kind of really difficult because you didn't know what was going to happen. You have to make a living, and so I had to work on, I got disability after a few months, and then you don't know what you're going to do for the rest of your life. And so thankfully for me, the people at McGee and my speech therapist and occupational and physical therapy people really helped me. And then, I became the ambassador for Bancroft brain injury people in the last couple of years, because they're in New Jersey and I know them from before. And so I live in New Jersey. So for me, it made sense to be an ambassador for them. And I do some speaking with the people that are there. I keep track of all the people that have had strokes, and I talk with them all the time. I try to give them encouragement. Used to visit at the hospitals, but now with all the things that are going on, everything's more virtual. And then we have a couple of events. We had the golf tournament at the Union League at the Shore, September 25th. And then we had the virtual event to give back to Bancroft, which raised almost $500,000 for the charity. And so after time, we still have to keep working at it. But I'm on the board of Bancroft, along with my boss, Jason Wolf, who just started. So we're one of the charities that we support the people that we have at Wolf events and other events.
So did I just hear $500,000 was raised?
At the virtual event, I think that for the golf, we raised about $240,000 just for the golf alone, which is pretty amazing. And with that, I give my time, but I also, I give a donate, like a jersey, and I started, I donated my Gaffaw cigar box, and so, I did a lot of things that just may add up to help a lot.
That's so during amazing. Your recovery, can you tell me about the Victor?
The Victor?
Yes.
So that, like, for me to help with skating?
Yes, sir. Correct.
Yeah. Yeah. So like at McGee, like they had a machine that that I used. So like I learned to skate with the whirler blades. And so like, and so like, just it helped me just because my balance has been really good right from the start. So I'd have to worry about my feet. And so I'm very happy that I still skate and play hockey, but the Venter machine made a big difference because, just kind of taught yourself how to think more about skating again. And so that's what I've done. Again, thanks to you, thankfully my balance is still good because, I've been doing some things that can help with your balance. And another thing that I've done is like I'm a distributor for Vox socks and inserts. They cost like $30 or $35 a pair. But it really helps with the balance of your brain. If you wear the socks more, it takes time. And then it's got an import that helps with the balance of your whole body. And I noticed when I play golf with the socks, it makes a big difference with my balance because when I swing, I keep hitting it straighter. And so I've noticed a big difference with my balance by using that technology. And so I'll send you guys like the link after that.
Yeah, please, because I have a terrible slice, so I need all the help I can get. I'm also a 15 handicap, but I'm just a bad golfer. So
yeah, well, it could really help.
And the only slice I have is pizza.
Yes.
So. Yeah. Oh, that's okay. That's good.
So what is Vox? Is it V-O-X? How's that spelled? Just V-O-X-X. So we have it for the podcast. V-O-X-X.
Yeah. Vox. They have socks and insights, and they have other things that they use too for your, but the socks, like they have a design on them that actually after time, it recalibrates your brain.
Wow, that's amazing. I wish I would have heard of that 8 years ago. My other question about your therapy, whatever word you want to use, is that I read that you do several treatments still up till today. And one of those is the Beamer, which a friend of mine is a very big fan of that. And I have used it once. So can you tell me about that and how have you seen positive effects because of that treatment?
Yeah. So the Beamer machine, it helps with the circulation in your whole body. So like, and every time you use it, it's a mat that's like, but 6 feet by, but you lie in it, like every day for 8 minutes in the morning and the night. So 8 minutes a day, and you have different levels that you set it. But you know, after time, I sleep every night with a Beamer machine. So like the circulation in your body kicks in for 2 hours and then stops and then kicks on again in the morning. But, you know, most people use the 8 minutes a day in the morning and afternoon because it helps for 12 hours. But circulation in your whole body with all the small capillaries in your body makes a big difference, especially people that are getting a little older, like their feet and hands and the blood flow, it doesn't work that well. And so ever since I've been using it, I'm a distributor for them too. So like, you know, it costs a little, like a lot of money just to get started. But the people that use it know that they're never giving it back. And it, after time, you know, it just pays for itself.
I've heard amazing things about it.
Yeah. And so but I haven't been sick the last 3.5 years using the Beamer machine. And I have tons of energy because when I skate in the mornings it gives me going. Like I know that when I skate, like I don't sweat as much. Like I don't get winded. It's pretty amazing. And like, it can really, with the blood flow in your body, take the place of medications, I think. That's just what my thought. Because the better your blood flow in your body, the better you get healed in your whole body. And then there's a couple of attachments that we can use too. Like there's ones a light, which helps with the skin. And it's only like 4 minutes a time, and then you kind of rub it around. And then people that have bad skin, it really helps with that. And then there's an elbow and it's called a spot. And there's a mat that like about 2 foot by 3 feet that you can use.
That's what I use. Yeah, use
a little bit more, like for 20 minutes. And so like when I play golf. When I first got started, like I had a stiff, and so I wanted to use the Beamer for my back for 20 minutes, and then that made a big difference because it made it much better. So, all the things that I've been doing have been really helped me.
So, in addition, that all those things sound amazing. We're already looking these things up, looking to try to buy these. So we're going on Amazon right now. Do you have any other holistic approaches? Do you take supplements versus medication or anything like that? Do you have other holistic things you do besides these apparatuses, whatever the term is?
No. Just the only thing that I take is a small blood thinner and a baby aspirin every day. So because I still have to with my brain, the blood thinner. And, but other than that, like I feel great. I have tons of energy. I'm up usually in early every morning and, stay up, all the time. And, I don't have to take naps like I used to when I played hockey. And, but it just, all the things that I've done over the years have made a difference for me. And also one thing that I did in 2017 was I did the Stelsem treatment in Colorado. Like they took the stems from my hip and put them back in my body. I got that from the NHL program that they had. So they gave me a free trip or treatment for Stelsem treatment. And I noticed that at that time, immediately it made a huge difference with my speech because, you know, a lot of these people are football players and hockey players. You know, they have bad necks and knees and shoulders. So I noticed a big difference with my speech.
That's absolutely amazing. I mean, the stem cell research has come so far, and it's still kind of poo-pooed a little bit, but I'm glad that they're starting to really look at that for treatments for the future.
Yeah.
I read that there's 800,000 strokes per year. 800,000 people have a stroke per year. And obviously, I saw some articles mentioning you and Luke Perry, who passed away. So my question is, do you think that people at a younger age are having strokes more frequently?
It looks like it now, especially with today's people. I think that a lot of people are getting heavier at a younger age. They don't take care of themselves. They play video machines all the time. They don't exercise as much. And it makes a big difference. That's what I think. They're not eating well, and they live a little bit different. And so to me, I think it's getting worse. Yeah, I know, because when I do some speaking, you know, I always talk about FAST, but now they said it's going to be, there's another thing that they have is re-FAST. So like they respond a little different. And so like that's the new thing that I'm going to be talking about soon.
Do you want to share a little bit about it with us? Or?
Yeah, I have FAST on my list. So what's the RE in addition to that?
So I just heard it like when I was with Bancroft, we had a meeting. And so like it just changed how it's looking. Like the RE is I can't remember it. I get confused, but I'll text you the how it is again.
Sure.
When I talk with Bancroft people.
So because Mark doesn't know, I'll let him know.
It's the same as FAST. But there's an RE associated with it too.
Okay, so it's the way you recognize a stroke. It's an acronym for how to recognize a stroke.
Yeah.
T meaning time, because it's so time sensitive.
Definitely. Yeah.
Super quick.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's amazing. And what I think one of the things that stuck out to me was about your hockey career. You did not lose a single tooth.
Yeah.
In your entire hockey career. And then you have the stroke and you fell out of bed.
Yes.
And then two are gone.
Yeah.
That's interesting.
Irony.
It's funny because I look at how you were brought up. Like you were raised on a farm and everything, and how healthy you must have eaten, how active you must have been, how physically fit you had to have been to be able to do that kind of work.
And, growing up in Saskatchewan, you didn't know any better. And, for me, we're in downtown and downtown, there's only one street. I skated when the pan froze, we skated for lunchtime, and we'd skate for all the time. And then, when it went to the rink in December and January, I went skated all the time because I had the ability to skate a little bit more. So that made a big difference for me, just skating and getting better with your muscles.
Yeah. So do you have anything you'd like to add about the charity that you're currently doing? Because then we can certainly move on to Wolf, and you wanted to talk about the real estate company as well.
Yeah. So I've been working with Wolf Commercial, where we've done a couple of other charities, like the hockey and the golf, and you know, we give back from that, and then we help other charities too. But I'm just a realtor. The way I work it with our team is that if I find a space in the U.S. and know the people, what I'll do is I'll work with another broker on our team and split the commission. So it's me using my name and the people that I know, to help us a much better. But you know, we do really well. We promote ourselves really well through Google, and we pop up number one all the time for real estate and things like that. So we do a lot of work with that. But, you know, for me at Wolf, it just, I'm happy to be there with the team. A lot of the athletes that work on our team are like lacrosse and football and other players like that. So, you know, it just makes a difference of working as a team, not as an individual, you know. And so, like, I've been doing that for the last 6 years, and I love that. And, you know, just to, you know, to kind of to finish, you know, like with Bancroft as their ambassador, you know, what I did is I started my own Gaffaw cigar brand from the Dominican Republic. You know, I started with 425 boxes of 10 cigars, and they're limited edition, numbered, and a little prize in them for 140. Like, that's 14 a cigar, but they're only one time. So that means that once they're sold, they're not going to be available anymore. So I have about 150 boxes left, because I've done a good job. It's been almost 5 months, so I've had great support from that. But every box I sell, I give a percentage back to Bancroft brain injury people, and so that's good. And they promoted for me, and you know, and now I just started a 5-pack of for $60. And everything's online. If they want to go to my GaffawCigars.com website, there's a place that they can order. And shipping is free for 5-packs. For the other kinds of, like, it's boxes of 10, and I have other boxes of 25, 24, and bundles of 25. It's a little more expensive. It's like 9 or 10 a cigar, but they're really good. I didn't want something cheap. That way, you know, they'll keep working on it, and but the taste is so good, and it's smooth, and it's outstanding. The people that have tried them before would keep ordering them, because I didn't want something cheap, so like wanted something that would be quality.
When did you start that?
Well, it took me a year ago, but I started like a couple of years ago, like in the summer, like when I was with my son Jackson and Ken Dunick, former Eagle. We visited Santiago in the Dominican Republic and visited a cigar factory from there. So we learned how to make them, smoke them, roll them, all about them. So I've been thinking about that for a few years because I like the cigar. Every time I on the golf course, I just wanted to try one. So I wanted to decide to make my own brand. So the way it works is that I have a licensing agreement with Vivente Cigars in the Dominican Republic, which means that I don't have to worry about being a manufacturer of cigars. I'm just going to be licensing through them. And so we work really well with them. Everything's online. But, you know, as people know, like, I always have boxes with me when at Haddonfield in New Jersey. So if anybody wants, like, I deliver it to them, and it makes it a little cheaper for them.
Yeah. And just so you know, we're going to put an affiliate link on our show notes as well. So you can go.
Yeah, that would be awesome. Yeah,
definitely. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, we're absolutely here to promote all those things, because you do so many good things within the community and the giving back. Are there still some of those limited boxes available? Because Chris and I are cigar aficionados.
Yeah, I smoked two yesterday on the golf course. I lost one ball and I smoked two cigars. So it was a pretty good day.
Yeah. So I have 150 boxes of 10 left. What I do is I usually sign them, you know, before when I have them at home, I put a picture of my Flyers card, and then there's a little prize. It's a ball marker that people get every time that they order one.
Yeah, we're both drooling because I'm the golf guy and he's the hockey guy, so this is going to work out pretty well.
So another thing I understood about the stroke is you said your right side has kind of atrophied or has been more damaged than the left. You were a righty and now you're a lefty. Is that correct?
Not by design. Like, I wrote with my right hand, but now my fingers don't work. So like they're just pretty straight. So I learned how to sign with my left hand now. Because the right side was affected by the speech and the right side and fingers, and so it's about as good as I can get. But you know, like I can still every once in a while go to Bancroft and do like a workout where I can stretch the arm a little bit and the fingers. You know, I tried some thing with my hand, Botox in my hand, but after time, it got a little better, but then it kind of just kept going back. And so, you know, I'm thinking about acupuncture to see if I could try that.
How about, have you ever thought about like CBD oil or anything like that? Any other holistic approaches?
I don't know if that'll work because like the fingers, like it gets cold, or they get strict. But I think that, you know, the vein, range of my fingers like are okay, but that it only goes so far. I think that the stroke in my brain like blocked little things.
Yeah, for sure. I know I work a lot with CBD oil and I know people who had a lot of the lock hand, you know, that hand where the hand becomes like a claw and it's helped loosen that up. But it sounds like yours is kind of the reverse problem. You can bend them if your brain can get the signal to you.
Yes, that's it. Yeah.
Okay.
So to go back, I'm so sorry because I would need to place an order here. Okay. So the cigar, the cigar package, I guess, with the signature and the ball marker is the $140 box, correct?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. I'm on the page right now.
What it does is that unless I have a bunch with me in New Jersey, if you're not that far, I can deliver them and then it'll save you $25 shipping charge. But
we are sadly that far.
Oh, well, maybe you
might. We are broadcasting from Phoenix, Arizona.
Oh, okay. Well, if you order more than, I think more than $300 worth of cigars, then it's free shipping.
Okay, perfect.
So speaking of which, because you're an avid golfer, do you make it out to Phoenix a lot? Obviously, our head coach of the Arizona Coyotes, I know you played with him at times, correct?
Yes, yeah. Yeah, I don't get much in Phoenix. I mean, it's just because, you know, it's just too far to go, and but I would love to, you know, if you I think that you guys, if you know some golf clubs, because what I'm trying to do is set up the Gaffaws cigars in my golf clubs. I'll give them a nice deal if they want boxes through me. And that way, like you, what I've worked with Rambleroff in Jaworski's clubs is that I've worked a deal with them for a box of 20-25. I'm going to charge them $200, which is eight a cigar. And then what they can do is they probably they can mark them up a little bit more, and then they could go from there.
Yeah, I have a connection at one of the I think it's the 20th. Best course in the state of Arizona. So we can get you that offline.
Yeah. Okay, good.
Well, definitely. And if you ever do come out, please know open invitation. You're well, I would love to break bread with you, and you know, you're welcome to come out anytime, especially being a golfer. Once the COVID thing kind of settles down a little bit, I know travel will be opened a lot more maybe in a year or so.
Yeah. That's now it's getting worse again too. So like, I know that, you know, it was nice. And then, because, you know, I just got married last September 25th. And so, you know, just, we had to be home for the first 4 months, and then just by together, but you know, we're doing well, and, you know, love being at home with my wife. And so it's, other than that, it's been going really good.
Excellent. Do you have any, do you want to share anything about your family or anything else, or anything else you'd like to talk about? We're here. We love the conversation. This has been so amazing for me just to be able to have a fun chat.
Yeah. So like, I know my daughter, she works at Comcast. She used to be a rower, a good rower, from Drexel. So she's been there for a year and a half. She works at Comcast now in Philadelphia. And then my son's in his fourth year at Rutgers, New Brunswick. He's also another rower, but he also a licensed captain in the summer and in Ocean City, New Jersey. He has his captain's license, and so he gives people rides to tubing and things like that. And so I talk with him all the time, and and my other brothers and sisters, like most, are live in Saskatchewan, except for my brother Ron. He just got a job for the city of Philadelphia, so he's going to be here in a couple of weeks as an IT guy. So, you know, just stay in front of these people and have a big family and lots of kids, and they're having kids, so it's worth living.
That's awesome.
My last question is, I read a comment that you made that during your recovery, it was going too slow. And that was a difficult thing for you to do. And I can relate to that because my recovery was, I wanted to get better every single day by a little tiny bit. And that was never the case. I would get better and then get a little worse and then get better and get a little worse. So how did that, the slow progress, how did you deal with that?
At the start, like I was impatient, you know, I was moody, and I just want things to happen faster. But you know, with your brain, it takes some time to heal. So after time, I figured out how to be much patient, to be think a lot clearer, and to take my time. And so that really made a big difference for me, just by giving the time to be much better and heal. People that I talk with stroke, they want things to happen fast. And I keep telling them it's going to take some time. So you might not be the same. You have to take your time and really concentrate on slowing things down, making it a little better. And, you know, again, I talk with other people. I think by me telling them to slow it down and taking their time, it helps them think about it rather than people that want to go so fast. And so it doesn't happen like that, especially your brain. It's injured. It makes a big difference, you know, and you might not ever get better, but you just have to think about it and be clear with people that it's going to take a lot of time.
Yeah, I could not agree with you more, but that's still, 8 years after my injury, that's very challenging for me to accept. And I read an article about a month ago by a neurologist, and he said, any brain injury is a lifetime recovery. And obviously he's way smarter than me because he's a doctor of the brain, but that was a huge light bulb for me that, hey, this is a lifetime thing that anybody with a brain injury is going to have to deal with.
Yeah. Well, yeah, we'll just keep work on it. Again, we're both fortunate that we're still alive, and you know, there's lots of ways to improve. You know, the things that I've done that have made a difference in my life, like the socks, the Beamer, the Stelsem treatment. You know, these things are, you know, that you're always looking for something to be a little bit better.
Yeah, and in addition to that is just the charitable event, the charity that you're giving back with this is just so amazing. All I see is you're connected directly to the stroke and how much you help others. Is that your best piece of advice, is to be patient with that? Or do you have like one of those big pieces of advice for you that you could share with everyone about that?
Yeah. So like, you know, I think you have to be patient, and, you know, like what we're starting at Bancroft, every 3 months, we're going to do a video with people that had brain injuries, and put them on a list, and then they can tell their story. So, and do that very, pretty quickly. Like, you know, it'll be like some of the meetings that I have at Zoom with the people that I know, 30 second commercial for the things that they have. And so like, that's what we keep working on, just to make sure that these other people are heard, you know, because, you know, a lot of people after rehab, like they keep falling down and not doing as much as they should. And it's a reminder that you have to keep up with things that you have, home and everything else that you do. So for me, just trying to slow it down and take my time.
I love that. I love that advice.
And thank you so much again for all the great work that you do with everything. I mean, you must be pulled in so many different directions, but it just sounds like you keep giving and giving. And I can tell you from, you know, Chris is one of my absolute best friends. And when he went through that, I remember I didn't even know how to even handle it for him, because I don't know what he's going through. You know, I can't imagine knowing what you're doing unless you've been through it yourself.
Well, why don't you guys think about doing a golf tournament in Phoenix, and I'll be there.
That's a genius idea. You talked me into it.
I think we're going to start typing things up right now.
Yeah, I can, yeah, no problem. Especially this is the best time of year, right? The grass is beautiful. The wet. It's 70 degrees today.
Nice.
That's a great, great idea.
And like I said, you're welcome here to our house anytime. And we have what's called the tree house is in Phoenix. Chris lives in Gilbert, which is, it's a suburb of Phoenix, but I'm directly in Phoenix. So anytime you want to come out, like I said, I think Chris and I are going to start brainstorming about maybe getting a tournament together. We would love that.
Find some sponsors. If you get the right sponsors, and maybe you can find a cigar sponsor that they give a little bit back, and where the place is, you know, how it works, and how much it costs.
Yeah, absolutely. And I've been involved with a few before, so I mean, I kind of know. I wouldn't say I'm an expert, but I do know the ropes a bit. So I think that's a great idea, and I'm an idiot for never thinking of it before.
Yeah.
Well, is there anything else you'd like to share? I mean, we're about an hour in. I am so grateful for your time. I'm sure we could share stories over non-alcoholic beverages all day.
There's lots of stories. Just have to take the time and keep up with it. But you guys will know that you have my numbers, and you can call me at any time you want. We'd always talk about it later.
Absolutely. And if there's anything you ever wanted to share, you have our number as well. So yeah. Feel free. We just started about 5 months ago, but we're starting to get a little bit of, we're starting to get a little bit of attraction going. And part of the reason we're doing this is because we care about people, and we want people to be better. And we want to share our experience with our life to help others with their challenges.
Yeah, that's good.
So once again, Mr. Proper Brian, thank you so much for being a part of this today.
Yeah, thank you for having me.
Yeah, can't thank you enough. Appreciate it.
Thank you so much.